Yeah. Yeah. Thank you so much, Rinpoche, for coming again and accepting another strange topic. And thank you for agreeing to teach us on how to design a contemplation. Yeah, and thank you all for being here. Enjoy.
Please generate proper motivation according to the path you belong to. We don't have translations, yeah?
Yes, we don't.
Hello. This is my friend. So, I thank Mr. Anna Schilling. It's always weird when... It's better when I say Mr. Schilling, yeah? I would like to thank Mr. Schilling for coming up with this topic, and he's right. It is something quite important, but usually lamas wouldn't really be fond of talking about, because when you are in a monastic situation, most of the lamas are subject to that. Were subject to that when they are growing up. Then they don't really have to be taught how to think, because that is the only way in the monastery. There's not much room left, so to speak, which is changing these days. I mean, of course, with all the gadgets now young monks and nuns have, and all the like, for example, a lama, a monk or a nun would be considered very, very good if he or she will stay in the room all day long, you know. Because, and it makes sense. In those days, you know, you are in the room, then there's nothing else than just, you know, all the books and, you know, statues, and to do just practice and the read. There was not much to do. But now we don't know. Lamas could be in their room the whole day, and they could be having social contact with hundreds of people. Then that's. But ideally, initially, like when I first entered a monastery, we didn't have cell phones, at that time, and there was only one landline telephone, and we would be basically like sort of like in a German prison, like the females' prison we went to, and it was so nice. You know, women were lying on the ground and chatting with each other, but they just cannot go out. They can wear whatever they want to wear, and then almost like that. And we didn't even needed watches too. I mean, forget about all the others. We didn't even need to know what day is today. It doesn't matter. If it's not Sunday, you know, it's none of your business what day it is. It doesn't matter anyway. And time too, we didn't have watches. I didn't needed watches for many years, because we have bells, and each bell we know, oh, lunchtime, oh, class, prayer time, you know. Then automatically your mind is like, it's like a water running through a pipe. You don't really need to guide it in any other way. It's the surrounding helps. But when we are not living in that kind of situation, and especially when we are living so to speak in a situation where we have only weekend things going on, like in a month maybe or 2 months you go to a teaching once or twice, and the bigger problem, a challenge I think for modern dharma seekers is that lamas do not stick. So when a lama does not stick, he or she doesn't stay at one place, and then on top of that there's a whole circulation of different lamas. Then each lama comes, some lama gives initiation, some opame initiation, then you are into the whole poa thing for a month. Then somebody else comes tomorrow and then gives you, I don't know, like we were talking about, you know, the Lujong practice or some Dzogchen. Then you're totally into Dzogchen for 2 months. Then it doesn't work, you know, like it's, how to say, there's no real continuity. And then, I mean, it's really bad already. The Indians really made fun of Tibetans when a Tibetan would receive thousands of initiation. Indians, usually, if you really look into those masters, they give only one initiation to one student, and that's it. One initiation, one teaching, one path, one deity, one mantra, and that was it. And then, so that's which is why they were so great. They were really great, because they were 100% dedicated to one path and one, how to say, teaching, so to speak. But Tibetans had this good fortune and like not so good fortune of not going by I guess we have, like in India you don't have Saptakaju Nyingma, like a big generalization like that. When you have a big generalization like that, then either you only practice one thing and then, you know, you try to continue it, or you have to try your best to integrate everything. And this is the problem we have. So, and on top of that, the similar things are being done in the West too, and then in the West or everywhere. Singapore, Malaysia, Lama comes and one initiation and then gone. Somebody else comes, Bodhicitta, and the, you know, ways of Bodhisattva teaching for 2-3 days and then gone. So then at the end, I think if I would be in that situation, I would feel like I'm getting a lot of information, but it's really not one of them is complete, so to speak. Complete, not one of them is, and also you do not have the time, because actually for just one teaching you need many years to really contemplate on it and to meditate and to practice, you know? And then you keep changing, like we keep changing, then it doesn't work. Anyway, we're trying to. So I think, of course, I will not be doing any justice to the topic by Mr. Shilling, but I would really suggest you also keep asking many lamas, like, you know, like learn it. And yeah, there are many lamas coming to Berlin again and again. And, you know, somebody like Khampo Rinpoche, I really admire her, the way that she teaches. I think, especially, it's important how a lama speaks, you know, sometimes. And the way she speaks is so elegant, and each sentence and words, choice of words is like, I was really like, one time we were speaking on Skype, and I had to speak right after her, and I was so nervous, you know, because right now, this amazing display of whatever you understanding or wisdom, and then you have to say that you have a guy who says something like that. It's really embarrassing. So some people like her is coming. I think if you ask something like that, this is one great quality of masters, is that you could ask very simple questions and receive profound answers, and very like seemingly mind-boggling questions and receive simple answers, I think. Anyway, so Buddha Dharma, we are quite unique, especially the traditions that come from India, we are quite unique. Unique, it's not a chauvinism, it's not just looking down on other tradition. We are unique in a sense that it is a path of transformation, you know. It is a path of transformation. And if there is no transformation, the path is gone. Doesn't matter you go to temple or doing like how many malas you have used up in your room, it doesn't matter. No transformation means there is no path. The path hasn't been born in you. So that is the big problem with our, you know, spirituality. And it's like Khyentse Rinpoche was, he, I don't know if you know this, he was very worried last time when we had this enthronement ceremony for the new Satya Thunzin, and he really implored and he kind of begged lamas to please pay attention to, like, you know, the population too, the population of Buddhist community, and it's really going down. And he actually kind of referred to a study done by, I forgot which organization, but, and he said they predicted that each year almost 1 million Buddhists is lost, no? Yeah. And that, and it's true, like if you look into countries like Korea, I mean, just Nepal, Korea is too far, don't you just look at Nepal. Now, each village has a church. Those who go to church get rice and money. And they're building, certain churches have Saturday night dance, you know, functions. So then youngsters go there. So in this way, and all the while, Buddhist lamas now are growing more and more. I don't know why, but we are not so, like, you will almost never hear a Buddhist lama teaching Dzogchen to a village grandmothers. That was the beauty of Tibet, and which is how Tibet managed to keep Dharma alive. Even, it wasn't just monks and nuns or like new people, like foreigners, you know? It was like Dharma was available to everybody, and lamas really wish to teach, people really wish to learn. This is going down and down and down. Look at Berlin itself, or any city. I'm sure there are hundreds of Tibetan, Frankfurt, we have a Tibet house there. But then when we asked to the Dharma Center, how many Tibetans come in? Nobody, not one. They come during Losar, you know, and make offering and then go. So the tradition is really going down fast. And it is very understandable, because our work is not done just by building a temple, putting up a statue, and inviting people to come. Our work is, you know, very complicated and it's understandable that of all the major religion, Buddhism will go down first. And if we are really sincere, it should go down first. Because, like we were saying, you know, like for example, like a Christianity, let's just say, because we are in the West, you know, you study the how to say, writings of your saints, and then Bible, of course, and then you do every week you meet, and then you function all these rites and rituals, of course, and then all. But then that's about it, you know. You do not have the burden of having to have a realization, having to have a deeper understanding of, you know, no one is really pointing fingers at Mother Teresa, and she actually wrote a lot of letters. For almost 10 years, she stopped believing in God. But nobody's talking about it because she's outwardly, she's really helping people. She's kind and, you know, like teaching, talking about God. And that's okay, that's enough for them. And so they will grow. It's quite natural. Buddhism, on the other hand, it doesn't really depend on the population, or it doesn't really depend on temples, or a lama or a Buddhist instructor could be sitting somewhere at the side of a cafe and talking to a bunch of people, you know, and really delivering really valuable teachings. So the whole question whether Buddhism can survive or not, Buddhism can survive in the West or not, depends on transformation. If the students do not have any transformation, then it will not stick around for long. After a while, people will realize, hey, you know, this Lama has been coming from 50, 60 years, giving initiation all the time. But look at this, you know. Look at this, like, how to say, long-time practitioner, so-called long-time practitioner. You know? I don't want to be like that. Because an example is so important. We need proof. So, for that, realization doesn't just come, and suddenly just praying is not working for us somehow, because we are not so simple-minded, you know. So just praying also does not work. Sometimes Lama, of course, like, yeah, we have a lot of devotion to the Lama, but sometimes the Lama says something strange, and then, you know, you start doubting, why did he say that, you know? Why did she say that? Why does she look at me in that way? All that paranoia. So a really deep understanding of the teachings. That is a sure foundation. Nothing can take that away from you, from us. Nothing. Our lamas may pass away too. It may happen in the world that Buddhists are seeked and persecuted, but look at all those great masters who were, and many of them gained realization in prison, and they really made dedications to those special, like, prisoners who really would beat them, like, periodically every week, you know, you have to go there once and then you get beaten, and then it's like you're going to a dentist or something. And this, in Tibet, really, some of the lamas, they really made dedication, and they said that it is that man who pushed me to practice every day. Really, I guess what I'm trying to say is, what is contemplation actually? What are we talking about here, contemplation? You're not going to write a text. That's not your aim, to write a book or to pass an exam. Contemplation here is to transform. Transform yourself. What do I do? All these teachings, you know. How do this, like, this weekend teaching and that weekend teaching, how do they communicate? What does it mean for me? That should be our aim. Even for a Lama who is teaching, should be his or her aim, you know, how to build a bridge between the different texts or different teaching he or she is giving. And for anybody, like, of course, from the listener's side too, definitely, you have really have to filter it with these questions, like how, like I said from the beginning, I will not do any justice to the topic. Like the topic is, I mean, the name is really nice. How to design contemplation. No, I don't know how to design, but we can talk about it generally. When you know why is it needed, when you know what is the problem, when you know all that, then the answer usually presents itself. Anyway, the longevity of Buddha Dharma, really, it's not like some lamas came and then there was thousands of people sitting listening. Sometimes you feel like that. You feel like, Dharma is going to live long. What do we don't know? Many of them usually, like when like someone like His Holiness Dalai Lama is talking, then there's 50,000 people in the ground. Many of them, they're not even Buddhist. You know? Maybe being a Buddhist is not so important, but here in this context, it is key for the longevity of Dharma. We need Buddhist people. We need serious practitioners. So it really falls upon each one of us. We do not have to become a teacher, but we can inspire people by the way we behave and act. You know, really, until now, Buddhists have slightly good image of being nice. These days, Buddha is getting associated with health and stuff, but why not? That's not so bad. Like nice, like doesn't harm, maybe more prone to become vegan, you know. It's not so bad. So the past, you know, all our those people who have come before us have not done such a bad job. But it is up to us now. But this is very it's very outwardly. Inwardly, we really need endless stream of blessing. We really need the continuity of realization, or else we are done. This is not like you read a book then you believe in God and then that's it, or you read a book then you know everything is impermanent and it's done. It's really not like that. Contemplation. Hearing, contemplation, meditation is the key and has to be done again and again and again. The great Tsongkhapa, he's really one of the greatest masters ever to walk in Tibet. And he said, and this is from his own experience, it's not like he's just saying it to be wise. He said, it seems the more you hear, the better your contemplation is. The better your contemplation, the better your meditation is. And if your meditation is good, that solves all the problem, you know. So really having a vast hearing, tapa jachava. When you have a vast hearing, you tend to know things. When you tend to know things, you are not led on a wrong path. It's not easy to lead you on a wrong path. The Buddha said, and he was praising hearing alone. He would praise it as if you just have to hear and that's it. But then I guess when he will pray contemplation and meditation, then again he will do the same. Anyway, so first thing I think a listener usually should do is to, this is very understandable, you should really from our side, first step would be, is it a Thangdam or a Ngedam, the teaching that I've received? Definitive. What is the Thangdam?
Yeah, provisional and definite.
Yeah, improvisational. Is it a teaching of improvisational?
Provisional.
Yeah, improvisational.
Just
Provisional, yeah. Provisional is much better. What's it provisional? Is it a provisional teaching or definitive teaching? That should actually solve most of our problem as soon as we hear that. And this applies to everything, starting from how your root guru dresses to really how, what he says, what he does. Just an example like the Kamapa. I think there was a ninth Kamapa. He said, if you really want to know my teaching, if you really want to know my teaching, look at what I did. Look at what I'm doing. Because the gurus may speak a lot of things depending on different occasions, depending on different students. But what the guru really like believes to be the heart, the guru will do himself or herself. Just an example. So from us listener, our side too, when we listen to a teaching and the guru is talking about, let's just say my guru is a movie maker and he's talking about his new project for 15, 20, 50 minutes, you know, I am not interested at all. So what do? I sit there and think, this must make a lot of sense to somebody. I do not get it. Why is he doing this? Why is he talking like this? I do not question it. I just think, I'm sure it makes sense to a lot of other people. Even if it doesn't make sense for me, so what? You know, like, so this becomes a provisional teaching for me, right there. It's just things like that. Anyway, whether it is really, should I really take it word by word, or should I really try to understand it in context? That's what it means. I think this is the door to really understanding a teaching or developing a contemplation. In the text, almost all of the Tibetan text and some of the Indian texts, in the beginning, when a master would write a commentary, in the beginning they would talk about Gursok Chushi. It would be said, for those who wants to know, why should I read this text? What is there in this text? Then comes Jyoja. First is Jyoja, to really think about the Jyoja. What is the topic here? What is the main topic here? It's the same with you, like us going to a teaching. What is the topic here? Or we are thinking later. What was the main topic that I heard, you know, that was talked to me today? Jyoja, that becomes the Jyoja. Then comes the Gurpa. Even though the main topic could be very nice, really, like this speaker or a lama is really giving a lot of pith instructions or something. But for you, if it doesn't have any gurba, any use for you, then it is useless. Of course, not in all the time, but let's just say you are in a retreat or something, like you are doing a Dzogchen practice, and then you meet a lama who keeps talking about the technique of debate, and the small details about it, and you listen to it, it's nice, but for you, if you really, you're like a yogi, wandering yogi, and really, no need to debate with anybody, for you it's useless, really. It's nice, it's good teaching, but not for me. So Gurpa becomes very important here. Gurpa, why this is taught, how this refers to my situation, my day-to-day life. Gurpa. And then comes Ningga. It's the same. When you practice, like when you contemplate, you always check the necessity. most of the time, the people like us, we end up doing a lot of sadhanas. Like our sadhanas takes a this thick, and we're just running through it. So the jaja is there, topic is there, but the gopa is not really there now. Maybe we are better off to do one practice for an hour, you know, properly, like 10 pages practice for 1 hour every day. If we would be doing this for 10 years, something could have happened by now. But and the sakyapas are so bad. If you are a sakyapa, you have to do chamin namshi. There's 4 different sadhanas you have to do. Every sakyapas have to spend like 2 to 3 hours. And I'm talking about monks. And you know how fast monks read, you know? Monks and nuns. You know? It's not thick like this because there is a lot of translations and transliteration. It's just Tibetan. And then this, like, really, then sometimes I feel like I'm really not focusing on one practice properly because I don't have time. You know, I have to talk to people, I have to do other things, I have to watch movies, you know? I cannot just keep doing this the whole night. So maybe I'm not thinking about the gopa here. Maybe I'm just being blown away because such of us have to do it. And it's not even a rule, it's just like we somehow now people has made it as if it's kind of a rule, but it's not. There's nowhere written like that. But so that I'm just trying to say the gopa, like always trying to check the motivation. Why do I have to do it? And then comes the Nyingu. Nyingu is the now the real result. Every teaching you hear, then you try to see how is this teaching going to take me there to Buddhahood, to awakening? How is it going to do that? When now this is very important. Actually, that alone, all the design is done. That alone question, how does this teaching helping me to become awake? How is this teaching going to take me there? That alone, the answer, you know, when you think about it, that alone should be enough. Anyway, so what is Nyingu? What is the end result of this teaching? Take me to enlightenment. What is the end result of my practice to take me and others to enlightenment? So how do they meet? That is the fourth one, Delva. This is what usually we talk about right before we teach a text. And which is why, you know, I guess questions like this were hardly ever raised. How do I do contemplation? How do I contemplate on the teaching? Because one way or another, actually, it is included in the teachings. But anyway, when you do like weekend stuff, then you don't really have time to go through in details like this. Yeah? Anyway, so that's when you're contemplating. It's really good to do that. Now, you cannot contemplate when you do not remember. This is the biggest problem. The Lama talks and talks and talks. After the talk, Lama himself have forgotten what he talked. Of course, the listener don't even remember it. This happens a lot. I've noticed, even myself, when I go to like his son, Dalai Lama, he is such a talker. I think it's fair to say you have no idea how he teaches. He teaches, you hear him talk in English, you know, like, be happy, you know, stuff like, you have heard him say stuff like that. But when he talks, in Tibetan, you should really, I've never heard any Lama speak in that kind of like, the command of language and the sophistication of his sentences is just so good. And this guy knows everything, really everything. And then we are mesmerized. I think only he can talk like that. He would start in Dharamsala. It's cold, we're hungry, you know. And, you know, he would start around like sometimes from 7 in the morning. until the 6 in the evening, you know, with 1 or 2 hours gap in between for lunch and rest. But people were like so, because he's just really such a command, you know, the commanding personality. But after, at the end of the day, all gone, you know, then there is no contemplation happening. Everything is gone. So the problem is that we were not really, so ideally, what you're supposed to do is, as soon as you read something, this technique was taught in our Shiddha. Like, we have so many commentaries to read, and you don't have time to read something twice, you know. You just have to go fast, or you're left behind. In the debate ground, you cannot say like, wait, you know. You cannot do that, it's done. So how do we memorize what this guy said, what that guy said in different, sometimes they just say, we're studying Umajupa, you know, entering the middle path. Like, at least 20 commentaries you can get your hands on. And especially a place like Dzongsar, where we have Sakya, Kagyu, Nyingma, and of course Gelugpas are like kind of included in the commentaries, because we like to challenge Gelugpas, because they're the best in a way, you know. So really, it's very difficult. So then, actually, Akempu actually taught us, like, okay, do this. You have to train it. You have to train how to have an eidetic, like, almost like a photographic memory. So if you just start reading from the beginning, it will not help. Initially, how you do it, you read one sentence, stop, think about it. You read the next sentence, stop, think about it. I mean, of course, it's difficult, but if you really, especially if you really want to master one text, you know, really want to have the bone and the marrow of the teaching, you know, then you need something like this. If you are good at memory, that's good. But usually what we do is we read the entire book, we remember what we like. Something strikes us like, oh, this is, and that's it, it's done. So the whole transformation cannot happen, because what you like, you're already doing. If you want to transform, you have to do something what you don't like. Usually that is the case, but we don't remember that. Because we skip through it. We do that. So that's the problem. So it would be really, this is what we are taught, to really stop and think. And it was true. After 2-3 years, we didn't need it to read a commentary 2 times. We have like 7 commentaries from 7 masters on 1 topic, they're all debating. You just read this once, leave it. Every monk, almost every monk. And it's amazing how our mind can adapt. Like, now when I look back, I was so great, you know. And I'm just a like medium-sized, you know, scholar in Dzongsar. But I was like, oh, I just had to read it once and it was done. I could read, then I could move on to other book, and later when debating, I say, he said this, she said that. But it's all gone now, because now the training is left. I stop reading. But that's how we should do, like today, okay, 1 teaching session is done. As soon as it's done, you don't start chatting and having tea. You know? Okay, you get your tea, and then still you sit and think. If you have written some points, and you think on the points. Okay, this, yes, it was said like this in the text. She explained it like this. That was cemented in your mind. You keep doing that a couple of times, then like your memory would be so good. This is something very like of experiential. We know this is how we do it. It's, of course, it will work. But it's so important, because you cannot contemplate when you don't remember it. And that's the problem. If you remember Shejin the Denpa, then you have Shejin. Shivala said, there have been many people who came along who were great in perseverance, great in compassion, who were really good in hearing, like, heard this and that, who go listen to every Lama talk, you know. and who had devotion, Shantideva said, in ways of Bodhisattva, Dumaya, and who persevere a lot, but Shishin may be but because they do not have what is Shishin?
Vigilance?
Yeah, vigilance, so to speak. Vigilance. They do not have vigilance. Then everything, like Lodol Pumbit, like a vase has a hole here, and you keep putting water, it's never going to fill. So if you really want to develop a contemplation, if you really want to not just end up going to different teachings all the time and never really having something complete in your head, then you really need this. You really need to remember what was taught, or else, I mean, of course you can listen to recordings later, which is worse. I noticed that before I had recording devices, I could actually almost remember the master's, like which words he used, like how he was, like how his hands was. But then I started recording, Even when the Lama is only talking to me, there is a recording device, as soon as I put it there, almost 50% of my concentration is gone, because I try to listen and I try to have some effect, but I do not try to remember anymore. Because I am so sure I have it recorded. And this happens a lot to us. And of course, this doesn't work, because how are you going to listen? Like, you go to 10 weekend teachings. When are you going to listen to all that? Each day the guy is talking for 5 hours. How are you going to listen to all of that again? While driving, then you cannot concentrate. Like, there's no time for that. We have to work. We have to do other things. So while you're doing it, when you're doing it, while you're doing it, make it work. This, I think, is quite important too. I do not know how this will be for you, but I'm pretty sure this will also work, since anyways, this is a very new topic for me. Somehow we usually expect people to know how to listen. This is what Kipu Kunga Monshu, he taught us, and he said, this is very useful. Explaining all the teaching yourself, teaching it yourself, whatever you have learned, you teach it yourself, not necessarily to someone else. So what you will find in Dzongsa, if you go there, every monk is like sitting in his room. I am sitting here, my room is sitting there, And we are both teaching, explaining. We will read one line and say, now this means, and we have to be loud or else you will fall asleep, Really, and then so when you do that, usually you find all the mistakes you have in a way. When you're trying to explain something, then you know how well you are understanding. This is the best form of contemplation. And especially if you are really teaching to somebody, Kempunga Wachu would say, the real study happens when you actually teach it to to a class. That's why he would really treat the Kempos like a student. When he was in Dzongsa, no Kempo had a special room. He would say, you are all students. Either you are teaching a class or you are learning in a class, or nevertheless, you are a student. Because this is what happens. We have a lot of information, and when we think about it, it's kind of, we have the meaning, And anyway, we think about this, I know. But when you really try to explain it, try to make the connection, how all 100 things, come to the one same thing, and how there is a hierarchy there. There is a, first this goes, second this goes. If you really do not try to Yeah, like without voicing it out, you really don't know how much you know and where is your weakness. So this is, he would really, you know, make us like talk loud, and like, and that's why it's like 500 monks you will find shouting in this room. Nobody's listening to you. Everybody is busy shouting his own text. But then monks are, they're reading one line. No, Gorampa said this, but then Tsongkhapa said that, and then he's like explaining and debating all by himself. But this really cements, like, you know, the whole of the vase, you know. It really covers it, and you really remember, I think. But of course, this is not like a once in a lifetime thing. You have to keep doing it, and you have to keep building. But this is something you can do in your own apartment, in your own room. Take a text, you know, really, like, explain. No need to post it on, you know, but just explain it to a wall, to an insect in front of you. Really, like, Padre Rinpoche would do that. He would go and he would be teaching ways of Bodhisattva to a bunch of fishes. He would really start with the, you know, the prayers, and he would really explain it to them as if they're understanding everything, you know. Like, and then he would dedicate it, and then he would go. I'm not saying that's why he became great masters, but I'm sure it really did a lot of good. Not only to the fishes, but to himself, really.
Maybe we should try that in our study group.
Yes.
Actually, yeah, I would really suggest, of course, this is very good, especially if you have a study group. Those people have to listen to you.
Oops.
And then they can also ask you questions. They can really challenge you. This is really good.
Yeah.
If you're all by yourself, then you're like a bathroom singer. No one is saying your voice is horrible. Then you end up singing suddenly in front of 100 people, tomatoes thrown at you. That's not good. But also it's good to, yeah, study group is really good. Please have that. And I would really recommend, like, please continue the study group and really try to meet as often as possible. I think the text is almost done.
Yeah, we're in the end of middle of the 8th chapter.
Yeah. That's really good. Anyway, let me see.
Let me just have a question.
Yes.
Like, with these kinds of techniques, you know, when I had the chance to be in the monastery and watching the monks, I was always so impressed by how they were able to remember, so, you know, memorize, and using these very simple techniques. I think it would be really interesting to see how, you know, as you suggested, we can adapt some of that to training Dharma practitioners, you know, like us. But I think for a lot of people, they maybe, you know, it's a little funny in the apartment, especially living with other people, it's like, you know, how to do this. Yeah, but yeah, it would be interesting to hear more these kinds of practical kind of things we can do every day.
It's okay, you tell your roommate. It's going to be weird. But this guy told us, so I'm going to try it.
Yeah.
It's very simple. You know, you're all by yourself reading a text, like just a ways of Bodhisattva, and you're explaining. And it looks weird for somebody.
But I guess it's like when
it's
some people,
so good.
When some people are like walking down the street and talking to themselves.
Yeah,
really
they could think that you're too. Or you could just pick up a phone and act like, you know. We were talking in Potsdam, yeah, that, you know, really smile sometimes in the subway, you know. Because this really struck us, like for me and Rebecca, as soon as we went into this tube, Berlin tube, we really noticed, like, there was suddenly everybody was, they don't even, they're not, like, and no one is really, there's no smile, nothing, everybody was so, looked so tense. I'm not that, I'm sure they're not that tensed, but and we were saying, you know, really try to smile sometimes. When you're tense, it's, sometimes it relaxes to look at somebody smiling. Then I saw some weird faces, and I thought, and if you think they think you're crazy, of course you don't smile for no reason. You look at the phone and act like you're reading a funny thing. Really, this is totally in your head what you do. But it really lightens the mood. Suddenly it changes. Like there was a video, even a viral video of this weird chubby guy who would go into subways and he would look at the phone. And it would start, he would start laughing. He's like a laughing champion, really. And at the end, first people are looking at him, what is he doing? And then everybody starts laughing, and then he would leave. It's so good. Of course, if you cannot do it. But just laugh by yourself and make them intrigued. What is he laughing about?
But what do you mean with explaining to yourself? Because when I'm reading the stanzas in which I have heart, and I try to understand them at first. But how do I know that I'm right? Maybe I can read some commentaries on it, and then it's all my own interpretation. And then I explain it to myself, and maybe I'm on the wrong path.
Okay. Until you hear yourself talk, you know, you will not really be that aware of how much you really deeply understand it, I think, until you're questioned. Like Sakya Pandit has said, without beating the drum, you're stupid if you buy the drum without testing it. For that, you have to beat it. You know? So similarly, no one should be called a practitioner or a scholar without being tested. So if best, like Manette said here, that, oh, we have a Satiguru, then you explain it there, oh, this stanza means this, then there is some back and forth going on here. Or else, if you are just by yourself, then you explain it by yourself, you will somehow, of course you will not catch all of your mistakes, but some you will, like while explaining, you're like, but this doesn't sound right, and then you read the commentary, oh, this is one kind of technique that we are taught, and it's really good. Very simple, but strange to do, but so effective that you will really be surprised. And of course, if you can debate. There was a time when we could debate with 10 opponents at one time. Oh my God, I don't know how our mind was at that time. I cannot do it now, I know. Yes, no, maybe, to like this, there's no time. Everybody wants to defeat you, you know. 2 people sitting, 10 monks standing. And like, not always they're asking the same question. These 2 are asking this question. Those 2 are asking another question. And they want to continue in their own line of, you know, logic. You cannot say, wait, you can do that, but then it's like you're not so great, you know. Say that you don't want to do that, you know. You want to challenge all of them. We could go for hours, oh my God. So much that, like, the mouth and the throat, everything is so dry, you know. Like, when we drink water, it actually pains. And then they bleed from here. To that extent we can go, like, because they're debating, they're so passionate. But you're able to reply to 5 different questions at one time. Don't, no need to think. Because if you do, they will do, so, this means, they do it 3 times, you have lost. And you cannot pause to think while in that monastic debate type. What I'm trying to say is it really sharpens our mind. And to an extent, we wouldn't even believe, I think. So study group is really good, then you actually, after like 2-3 weekends of study group, it would be great if you could have a debate. Anyway, I will say some things that is in our hand, like the one here, and then I will talk about things that are not in our hand. That is something else. Now, usually, so when a master or like someone like Buddha, he talked and we read his teaching, or we went to a teaching and heard some things he or she said. Now, to really contemplate, to really analyze, I'll just say it just for the sake of saying, because it's very general and very important, is that if it is teaching about something that is very visible to all of us, you know, then it should not go against the Monsum thema. The two themas?
Valid cognition. Valid cognition.
Yeah, like direct.
Direct valid cognition.
Yeah, direct valid cognition. Like if he's talking about, he or she is talking about something that can be experienced by myself directly, or you know, like, then we check, is it going against the direct cognition? Direct cognition means something I can see directly, hear directly, listen to or smell directly, feel directly. Then if he is talking about something that cannot be experienced directly, but that it needs it needs to refer to something else, then you will think, okay, so this guy said this because it happens, you know, this happens because of that. Then you analyze it and see. That's how. So while you're doing it, all the contemplation is being done too. Things are being remembered again. Things are being revised again. But if he's talking about something that is like way beyond both direct cognition and indirect, like, you know, inferential cognition, then we see, okay, he talked about path, you know, path and all that. Like, if he talked about emptiness, it's kind of like, you know, you can look at the reasons, or if it's talking about karma and cause and effect and all that, then you can really kind of guess. Okay, he said this, this and this and that, and it's like this, maybe cements things in ourselves. But if he's talking about path, if he's talking about liberation, awakening, then we depend, like things like that, not only that, something that is totally beyond our normal human reach, then we depend on what the Buddha said. Is it going against what the Buddha said? Is it going against what the lineage guru said? This is just something, I just want to put it there. Anyway, like I said, I do debate. It is very, I would really encourage you to also have interviews kind of, you know, like with your lamas or elder practitioners. You know, like, oh, just, I would like to talk something. And then you, like, can I say something? This is how I understand, you know. Is it okay? Not to show off, of course, but to really, to genuinely be sure that, you know, and usually those people would assist you and then give you more. This is also one of the best tools of contemplation. Because there are two types of things that imprisons us in samsara. Two types of obscuration. One type of obscuration can be dispelled only by knowing, only by having the information. As soon as you have the information, it's done. No more doubt.
Like
let's just say, the bliss of compassion, you know, or, yeah, the, you just have the information, you experience it directly. Or, like, the masters usually like to give the example of, you remember there are, I think some of you are still here from the 400 verses, yeah? There are two types of self-clinging. One, it is natural that even a cow have, you know, even a cow will have, just naturally thinking, I, not necessarily, you know, I am permanent or nothing. And another type of thinking, self-clinging is taught to you by a school. There is a soul, that is the real you, this body is not you. The soul will go to the next life, the soul came from God, all that. This type of self-clinging, it only needs the information, you know. The moment you start questioning, but where did God come from? How is this working? Blah, 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 all the information in the text, gone. This type of clinging, you, once you have the, like, understanding that it's stupid, you will not think like that again, it's gone. Now the problem is the real self-clinging that everybody has. This doesn't help. Information will not help that much. So the real transformation here is needed, you know, to really get rid of that self-clinging that we have from the beginning, so to speak. The moment we are born, we have it. Nobody teaches us that. For that, now all the practice, meditation, now all the, we need these things. So contemplation is no different. You hear things again and again. You hearing means also reading. You read it again and again. And then you think about it again and again. That's how you get rid of things that cannot be get rid of just with the information. Things like, many things like in India, there are schools that still talk about the permanence of sound. You know, sound came from, first sound was made by Shiva when he did his damaru. So from that came all the vowels, and you know, so they really believe, I mean, not our sound, but the sound, the speech of Brahma, it's still here in the sky, they say that. And you can hear it when your meditation gets better and better, because of course, it's still here. It can never go anywhere. So it's in the space, so you can hear it. So the belief that sound is permanent, then you read a Pramana text written by Dharmakirti that dedicates an entire chapter how and why sound cannot be permanent. And if you really understand that chapter, gone. No longer you will think sound is permanent, because that is easy. Now what is not easy is the linkage. What is linkage?
Coal merchant.
No. Linkage, yeah, coal merchant, but there was coal merchant, I guess. Like, from the moment you are born, you have a clinging, grasping to the sound. You know, to the sound. There is a sound. You do not have to think the sound exists truly. As soon as you have that clinging, it is done. You know, like for you, it's something existent. You do not have to know that you think, you do not have to know that you're clinging to it. You do not have to know that for you it is something truly existent. It just is like this. So something like that, the natural self-clinging that we have, this is very difficult. And for that, you really need to listen again and again and contemplate. So, now, of course, contemplation too. Like if you, okay, Ways of Bodhisattva. If you read Ways of Bodhisattva, actually, if you just read the root text in one day, there is a, I don't know, monks would read it, 1.5 hour, 1,000 times. But actually, like your mind is water. If you just let it, if you now you want, you have a, you know, a cup full of water and you want it to reach that wall, and you just do this, it doesn't work. You know? Then you put it through a pipe, you know. There's no distraction, like no, it just reaches there. It's like that, really, like you really, it's, you really feel like your mental capacity is channeled. You know, each sandas pushes you further and further and further. That could be a great tool of contemplation. Like, to not stopping, sometimes, most of the time, like we should stop at one stanza and think about it. You know, but sometimes just read it, just understand it, read it. That really, it really does something. And actually, usually that's how Tibetans contemplate. They would, like Kepu Kungpa Wangchuk would read this text every day in the morning. I wrote some stuff, but it's weird now. we are still talking about things that is in our control, okay. Now there is something called Pecham, Pecha retreat. We need that, really need that. And here you could be somewhere in a wood cabin on the side of a mountain, reading your Pecha and shouting all day. It's just, it really, the whole atmosphere will change. The Pecha will really talk back to you. Or you just read. But Pecham is so important. Not necessarily when you go to Tsang, you have to finish some mantra. No, just, this is what usually, like lamas, they love to do, is that every year, sometimes they would, like, for 10 days, they would just read Pecha from day to night. And it is their retreat. They say, okay, for 10 days I'm reading text, all those scriptures. And many wonderful things happen. Many things that you didn't thought so important, suddenly very important to you. Because when you read Pecha all the time, these Pechas are actually like the Xerox copy of the great master's mind, you know. So your mind is like somehow becoming similar to that, at least for 10 days. Really, it's really good. I really, especially for us, you know, we do not have that much courage. I guess especially Germans, you do not have then that many Western, like German Buddhist teacher. Why? Look at the Spanish people. Like they study for 5 years, they have their own centers. What happened to Germans? I'm just joking here, but it's good, really, I appreciate that. You really want to be thorough, but this, it really, you know, in the beginning when I first like became a lama, so to speak, I was actually in school until 17, but then, and then I read even the stories of my predecessor. I thought, I can never do that. Oh, what? He spent what? Like, you know, they were like so unreachable. And this is what many people, they complain. You know, like, they say, like, yeah, but these great masters, they're unreachable. You know, it doesn't speak to me, so to speak. We cannot relate to that. That's what we say. I cannot relate to it, to myself. It's because you surround yourself with ordinary things all the time. Then how can your mental capacity go any further? You do the same thing, only same result can happen. This, I really experienced it. Then I started reading all my 12, 13 years of Dzongsa. I really didn't study at all, but I read the stories. Oh, I read so many. Oh, this, like 7, 8 volumes of Lamde Vinaya Guru stories, and you know, their life stories, all the Kagyu, Nyingma. And at some point, you really feel like, even the way you walk is different, really totally infused. Like, it's the same water, but you put a little bit of lemon on top of it. And the whole water tastes different, smells different. You're the same person, but you think, you know, if I do this, you know, like if I go to retreat for 10 minutes, even I can do this. And this is so important, really, to have that. And this is not boasting, but because we humans are like that, like our mind is now, you know, channeled in that direction. And then that type of tendencies come to rise up in our head. This is natural. This is so important. Like many people criticize the autobiography of Ralo Tsawa. It's a great exorcist. He himself said, I killed 13 great bodhisattvas. He killed Marpa's son. It was really bad. It's great master. Many people criticize because it's almost superficial, like, it's almost like supernatural, it's fake, you know. This guy does this and everybody falls down. Really, like, but I really admire it, you know, because I wouldn't want to practice something like Yamantaka, you know, just by hearing some cute stories. I would want to practice it by hearing really crazy stories like his. And his story is so crazy, this guy is total lunatic. And I really admired it, and I it's like this thick volume, his whole life story. And he was so, he had four wives, three wives, and still he was giving monks wow. You know, he didn't care. He said, I am done. Like, for me and Shakyamuni, there's no difference. So why cannot I do it? He would do it. And then many lamas would go to debate with him. A great Kadampa master went, and he was really saying, you know, in Vinaya, you cannot do it. Ralozawa picked a handful of cup, pin, you know, cup. To sew the clothes?
Needles.
He picked a handful of needles, put it in his mouth and swallowed it, and picked a thread in it. That was his answer. He picked a thread in it, and from his private organ, you know, from the mouth of his organ, he pulled the thread. All the needles there on the thread. He said, when you can do this, there's not much left for you, whether you're married or not married, monks or not monks, give vow, not give vow. I really love that. Now I would want to practice Tantra. Not just some cute story like there were flower of rain, like rain of flowers, and like rainbows on this practice hut. It's good, but it's not that easy. For somebody really bad like me, and you need to push like this. And what I'm trying to say is, yeah, I really like to totally try. If you want the best type of contemplation to happen, you have to immerse yourself in it. Like, give no chance for anything else, at least for like 2 days in a month, or 1 day in a month, the whole day and night. Immerse yourself, starting from like, you know, like, okay, Saturday, Sunday is holiday. Starting from the night of Friday, you kind of decide, okay, this weekend I'm on retreat. And then you return again and again and again, sometimes slowly, sometimes this chapter 2 times, and sometimes read the autobiographies of the masters. Jassi Mushu told me, how did he practice? Then, actually, that is the design. The main, the best design. Now, these are the things that we can do. Now, there are things that, I mean, we can do, but not really in our control. Things like devotion, things like merit. Like Dzongsa Kenzi Rinpoche would always advise us to, he would say, you know, you guys, because he would come to Shedra, you guys read this text every day again and again and again. Why don't you take a break, do like 10,000 of mandala offering, you know, really from the depth of your heart, mandala offering, to aspire to really reach the depth of the text. Nothing should be left. Everything that I need to become enlightened, I must understand it from this text, you know. And then you read it. He said, I will guarantee you, after that kind of merit, your understanding will be double. You will understand many things that you never thought you would. And I really like that. And then, of course, there are many other techniques. Let's just say you're a practitioner, you know, I guess almost all of us have Manjushri initiation or Tara initiation. Then really, while receiving teaching, any teaching, as long as it's Dharma, like Kinzen Rinpoche would say, like, he said, to, you know, visualize Manjushri in front of you, or whatever your deity is, and then that deity melts, really totally gets inseparable from the text, and then while you're reading, all the words of the text really goes into you, into your heart, and it's right there, in a way that you really like have a firm belief that it is really changing me, like deep transformation is happening. Then you read. This is what he usually advised, like, not usually, but he advised to them, to us one day in Dzongsar, just as a general advice for the monks, whoever reading, studying. This really, from my own, like, limited experience, that when I was, like, 11, 12 years old, my grandmother would love to read this tantra, short tantra. I had no initiation, nothing, of course, but I don't know how it worked, but it kind of worked. So she would make me read it, and I used to hate it in the beginning. It was like, it would take almost 30 minutes, but she cannot see, and neither can she read anyway. So she would listen, and I have to read. Every day, reading, reading, reading. Then you kind of start to understand one word. You know, like, let's just say there's things like, whoever read this three times in the day, three times in the night, there is no doubt, like one sentence, like it will be born, he or she will be born in Kachari, right next life. Tantra, there's this tantra, Buddha, like in the Kanjuri, talk with the Buddha. It intrigued me, like, wow, just by reading? I was a school kid, I thought, I don't have to do anything. I mean, of course, when it comes to the highest tantra, it is a total path of blessing now. Intellectual doesn't matter. You could be a donkey, it will work, or you could be the best mind, it may not work, because it's like completely about... It's true, isn't it? When you reach the core of tantra, even the idea of God sounds nice. It kind of correlates, like, make relationship with the real, like, how did everything begin, you know? Like, I don't know. I guess it's kind of strange, maybe I'm mistaken, but I feel like that. I got more and more. Nobody explained it to me. There was no one to explain. But this, after 7-8 months, you kind of understand the whole text, you know, because I think the merit was being generated while you're reading, because you feel, oh, it's important, oh, it's great, there's some Buddha's teaching, and you don't understand it, you're just a kid, but you, with devotion, then you read it. After a year, kind of, like, understand the whole, it's just personal experience, and I'm just trying to say, is now, this is something that is not in our hand, but we could do, is like, really pray and aspire. This is what Kempo Kongkhar Wangchuck would do, and he also told us that. He said, most of the things, the learning was not so difficult for him. Of course, he was a great scholar. But he said, sometimes when he would have doubt, then he, before sleeping, he would make a little offering to his altar and really pray to his root guru. And he said, there was nothing that cannot be solved. Like, when he would wake up in the morning, he would know the answer. these are the things that we can do, but really not in our hand. But I think this, yeah, it's quite doable actually if you really do it. Anything? Yeah, let's stop here. If you have any questions for this, we. I don't really know what to say actually. You could just blab on, but there's no essence to it. Or if you have any questions, please raise. Or then there's another like a matter that we would like to talk about.
When you're explaining about that the first ignorance of self,
mm-hmm.
or even the concept of, or even song, attachment to self, or attachment to song, the original attachment to self, so for example, if you take the example of sound, and you realize that. You know, you're. I don't know how to describe it, but you go beyond this attachment to sound as it seems to be,
mm-hmm.
and you are able to understand that. How do you function in a society that still has attachment to sound?
How do you function after understanding that sound doesn't really exist?
Mm-hmm.
I guess you know the logic. Now this also, here again, contemplation is very important. The logic that sound doesn't exist, I think in the 400 verses it will come later, the emptiness of sound. It is such a great text actually. He really takes time to dismantle almost everything, you know, mind, self, sound, time. It's almost like he had nothing else to do. And the logic that dismantles sound, if you contemplate on it again and again and again, when you hear something, we call it nyam. Nyam is not a real realization, but it is an impact of all the studies and practice you have done. You sometimes feel like, you know, there is a certain moment when you really stop to, and you're not really analyzing, but you're really questioning. I'm hearing it, but you know, is it there? I mean, these experiences will come. Of course, it's all very natural if you contemplate on how the sound is not there again and again and again. Like I said, this is not like how, you know, this is not something that you just hear it once, you understand it, and then it's done. Like, you know, like sound is permanent, this kind of ignorance is gone. Like the earth is flat, I may think so. Somebody will take me to, or show me a video or something, you know, like of how earth is not flat, you know. And that's it. But this is totally different. And if you really want to know, just to be saying something, I will say, oh, then treat sound as a dream, you know, an echo. But it doesn't help. You need an experience. For that, you have to really contemplate again and again while you are hearing how it is not really there. Like, you know, talking about Chandrakirti, and in this text too, I guess, and Nagarjuna, all of them talks about how we never really walk. You know? Then while you're walking, then you apply those logic. He says, like, how there can be never really be something called walking. Because to walk, you need to touch. So there has to be something called touching. I don't know. So as soon as you do this, there is no touching, your feet and ground. As soon as you do this, it's touched. This is not touching. In between, there is no such thing as touching right now. You understand? of course, when we say to the people who are not trained in this manner of thinking, sounds so stupid. That is touching for them. This is touching because it's very crude. Usually how our mind works, this is the touching. But actually this is already touched. There is no touching. In between there is no, this is yet to touch, or yet to touch, already touched. In between there is no such thing as touching. And you keep thinking about this. Same with sound hitting your ear. Hearing, where is it? As soon as you hear something, it's already heard. yet to hear. There is no such thing as hearing, the process of hearing happening right now. Like, it's very minute, but of course, you are a practitioner of Madhyamika, you should be brave, you should be able to go, like take the next step. You know?
But what if you realize that and you still live in a world where everybody behaves in sound?
Oh, it should matter to you then. If you really realize that, if you have some experiences, you still hear it, you still like good song, you know, listen to good songs, but now it's just, you enjoy it in a different way. Any questions? Because it's a little difficult to...
Perhaps like a little, I don't know, a comment or that I realized by myself that sometimes I thought that I had contemplated on something, but then I realized that I did it like pretty much intellectually.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes there are some things where I realize in the way I study the Dharma, I kind of get it, I think that I contemplate on it, but then another level is not reached, like as if these contemplations then don't touch me on a felt level, on an emotional level, like. And I feel that this is pretty much the gap that is missing. This fact of making these things also having a root into an experience which has to touch the emotional part, because otherwise it will not permeate. And this is like the experience, like that so often things happen, my intellect, oh, I know it, but the emotions go wherever they want. And that's the point where I'm asking, it's 5 years that I'm doing this, and this hasn't transformed yet.
Yes.
And this is where I really always like kind of ask myself, why?
Mm-hmm.
What's happening there? Because on that level, there are really big resistances. So how to approach this level? Because this is another level, I feel. And it has to describe it in another way. I don't know.
We are talking very generally here now.
Yeah.
We are not talking about one topic. So just to say generally, motivation rules everything.
Mm-hmm.
From the moment you hear one sentence and you have the motivation, I will use this for my path. Then automatically the question comes, how is this going to help my partner? How does this help me to reach there? In the beginning we talked about the four Gosok Choshi, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
The four most important things about a teaching or a text to contemplate is, what is the topic?
Mm-hmm.
Is it relevant? If the master says there were certain texts in India that really went in depth about why the crows don't have any teeth in their mouth. It doesn't matter, it could be so brilliant and it's useless for us. It doesn't have any teeth, that's it, okay, it's done. This, what will we do with this? It's not going to have the meditation or anything. But so, like, I hear something wonderful today, okay, but is it relevant to me? Things like that, I guess. You really have to make it personal. Where do I stand here? Or else, it's or else it's like counting someone else's money. You know, you read this text about great bodhisattvas, all the practice they do, the it's like you are still here high and dry. Nothing to, then it's like really you are a bankrupt person, you know, really like filling your book with their account, and you know, it's nothing really, you don't get 1 cent from it then. You just count their money, what's the use? Make it personal. I think it's best not to have a specific answer in a way, anyway I don't have, because when you just want to make it personal, you just find a way by yourself. Usually we do, we don't have to be taught. We just know. Anything else someone would like to share or ask? Or else I would like to talk a little bit about 84,000. We were. So you are the victims today. we are also trying to, of course, I mean, you all are aware of 84,000, but if we don't keep talking about it, people tend to forget. So, in short, it is really trying to it's like all this teaching, you know, the Dzogchen and Shakchen, we have it. It is like the heart and the, you know, veins and the lungs of Buddha Dharma. But without the body, where do you keep it? We need the body. We don't know where to place it. It's like going to all these weekend teachings and some retreat, but not really having a real complete picture of Dharma. That's where we need the words of Buddha. Really, that really shows, like, that really shows and teaches what is what goes where, what should be done when. And anyway, it is the authority, it is the final voice. For your own self, for our own self, to really know that this text, this teaching is completely authentic. Anything, like, which is why, like Tibetan lamas, they're never challenged. No one can really challenge them with like saying, you know, this deity worship, it's devil worship. Many Theravada people say, but they could never really write one proper text challenging that could not be answered. Because we, these Tibetan people, they were very clever. The king, he was so great, he translated all of the Buddha's teaching. He could have just translated those he, you know, was relevant, he thinks relevant, or those he thinks not relevant, he could have left. But he made it a point, some that he couldn't find in India, he sent people to China, invited Chinese masters, and then translated. There are five or six volumes translated from Chinese. Then you add on all the, that, those are like the cherry on top, so to speak, in all the Tantra teaching. The practitioners can never be challenged intellectually and otherwise, because there's all they have their feet. They can always fall back on the words of Buddha, quote it, think about it, read it. So we need this in English language too, and other languages. The language is now the new Buddhist, so to speak, society, like recent Buddhist society, need to depend upon. This is so important, I think. When you really know Buddha's teaching, there is no room for charlatans. Really, there is no room for weird, new age explanation, not so much. So this is very important for our own sake, that the authenticity of the teaching does not wane. So, Kinsir Mbuche is now, as you know, under the Kinsir Foundation, we are translating the entire words of Buddha. So we have two ambassadors, it's so nice to say to ambassadors here for 84,000. And I was told to say a little bit, and you know, please, please support it however you can. You just talk about it to somebody, really, just say it. Like some youngsters you think can, you know, learn Tibetan or Sanskrit, you know, and start translating, you know, you really kind of like push them, so to speak, like, if they want to, of course. It's not like you against their will, but you really think, oh, yes, you know, it's very good, it's very important, and it really is. And when you do that, then you're one of those people Buddha, you know, he was talking about in the sutras. He said, oh, like the sutra we are translating right now, the Sumati Sutra. It's a wonderful sutra about a little girl. A little girl, no one knows her age, but she looks like 8 years old. And she goes to Buddha and asks these amazing questions. How should Bodhisattva practice? And how should Bodhisattva, you know? And the Buddha gave a lot of answers, and she says, I will practice all of it. And then the arahats, you know, Mangalyana Putra, they're like, oh, what is this girl saying? You know? And is it like a little girl? You know, like, how can you say this? Do you have complete control of your mind? And then she gives weird answers, like Mangalyana knows, okay, this person is beyond me. Even Manjushri comes, she mocks Manjushri. You know, remember? Manjushri is speechless, he doesn't know what to say. And then the Buddha says, oh, Manjushri, you don't remember her. She was the one who set you on this spiritual path. She was your first teacher. You know? Then Manjushri says, I remember. You know? You're translating the sutra right now. Such a wonderful sutra. And at the end of the sutra, Buddha says, anybody, like in future time, anybody who reads it, keep it, teaches it, talks about it, makes other read it, makes other write it, you know, which have immense, like, more merit than making offerings to all the Buddhas combined. Because when you're making offering, you're just offering this. No? I mean, in a way, that's about it. But when you're talking about it, you're contributing to the continuity of the activity of Buddha. Of course, if any of us could contribute financially, why not? But we, more than financial support, we need more translators. You know? We need practitioner translators. Translators who practice. This is very important. And please do that. Please talk about it. Post it on Facebook. Like new sutras, isn't that publishing? You just put it on your wall. Or take some favorite phrases from it, you know, and then post it. I don't know, just do whatever you do. I think that's what the advertisement is. And you guys would like to say something?
What was the name of the little girl?
Ah, Sumati, Bodhisattva Sumati.
I think you really said it much better than we could have said it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming here too. I could see that some of you really come here like again and again, and in a way, supporting the center. This is very important. This is a learning place. It cannot last when people stop learning. It cannot last when teachers stop coming. So for that, even if sometimes when you feel like this is something I'm like the text Ways of Bodhisattva, even if you know it's something you have already learned before, you know? But then when it is taught, for the continuity of Dharma, maybe if you can, if you have time, you're not really doing anything that day, it would be good to go. I mean, of course, if the guy is shady or the organizer is weird, you know. Then you have your reason, I understand. But this is one thing that sets us apart from all the other tradition. The Mahayana tradition, Asanga said, in the Hinayana, like, you know, like not Hinayana, Theravada, let's just Theravada tradition, you become monk to be free from samsara. You become monk, maybe you really like the path and stuff like that. But for the Mahayana, the best thing is you become monk for the longevity of Dharma. Doesn't matter. For you, maybe it doesn't matter whether you're a monk or not. You practice by yourself. Similarly, you go to teaching for the longevity of Dharma sometimes. Of course, you may have heard it many times before. But if you feel, if we feel that, oh, I actually know quite well, I don't need anything else. But still, because, yeah, places like this, it is a door for many. And no teaching places should suffer. So we end here, please. I don't know what to say now. I said everything. What do you want me to say?
The dedication.
Thank you so much. Oh, it's so sweet.
Oh. No, really, thank you so much.
Since you mentioned Kamala Rinpoche, you know, I always have the feeling when I ask her something to teach, she's delivering much more than I ask for.
Yeah.
And the same today, so.
Thank you. Wait, dedication. Sonam di tanji vipa, tomni ni vedana, jagarna jepara pukpa, sibe sobre tovara tovara. May I, in all my lifetimes, carry far the weight of Dharma. And if I cannot do so, may I always be worried that the Dharma is degenerating.